Today is a very auspicious day when we are again able to see our Dr. Chandra Reddy Garu, who is very much familiar to all of us here. And I requested him to give a talk on some topic of his like, but today it has come out what is his like type book. So he wants to talk about the 10th man's story, symbolism, etc. and lead spirituality leading to moksha, the emancipation. Because we are always looking for the emancipation. We don't want to live upon the earth constantly for long, long time. So for sufficient time, whatever God has granted, that we should fully utilize for the benefit of us and try to elevate ourselves. So not much, and Dr. Chandra Reddy is a medical doctor. And he has journeyed a lot, he has cured and healed and helped so many people. But still, his attention and study and liking for the spirituality or our scriptures is really a Puro Janma Punya. And we are also sharing that Puro Janma Punya of him with his talk to us. And not myself speaking much about Dr. Chandra Reddy, he will also introduce himself something, whatever he wants, and then he will just talk to us. We'll be enjoying the wonderful speech by Dr. Chandra Reddy. And I am very much thankful to all of you whoever have joined or going to join and would join. And I invite all of them. It's a beautiful arrangement which has been done by our Kendra student. Now I request Dr. Chandra Reddy Garu to start his speech and make us enlightened with this. Because we always talk about something, but the story, so story is only are important to impart a lot of knowledge and wisdom. That has been the practice of Indian literature, and I request Dr. Chandra Reddy to take the mic. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Om. असतो मा सद्गमय तमसो मा ज्योतिर्गमय मृत्योर्मा अमृतंगमय ओम शांति शांति शांति. इट्स माय प्रिविलेज एंड अ ग्रेट प्लेजर ऑलवेज टू स्पीक टू द वेरी इलाइट एंड एंथुजियास्टिक ग्रुप ऑफ सत्संगीज. First of all, let me tell my heartfelt thanks to Sri Prabhakar ji. Prabhakar garu, known to me for many years through here and also back in India. A year ago, when Prabhakar ji invited me to speak as a keynote speaker at the Kendra, which is the Nadam Veda Vidya Kendram, Veda Adhyaya Kendram, and association with the waves, they have organized an annual meeting. At that time, I had an opportunity to speak on the essence of the Bhagavad Gita. And today, that we'll be sharing our knowledge. It's an extension of that Bhagavad Gita. And we have many stories from Upanishads. And this story and today's topic is the 10th man story, a spiritual journey to the moksha. Unlike the education today, the education in the ancient days was different. First 12 years, the children are with the parents at home, bonding, learning. But later on, at the age of 12, they used to go to the Gurukula. And a Gurukulam is organized by all the enlightened seers and rishis. Either they go to the home of the rishi if he is married, or if he is not, they will be going to the hermitage. They usually pick up the kids from the villages, and then they keep them 12 years, educating them in all sorts of sciences, which the Veda all our Vedas have all sciences, all arts, all literature, everything you want. So it's a comprehensive knowledge was taught for next 12 years. And at the age of 24, they will be sent back either to pursue in Grihastha, married life, doing their duties with the learned knowledge, earning and learning, or they can also go to sannyasa, preaching and, you know, teaching everywhere. It's their choice. So this story is from the one of the Upanishad, and this Upanishadic story has a deep hidden meaning. Now, this story is not just for the literal sense. We need to understand the deeper meaning. So we will go through that story first, then we'll go and explain and discuss the adhyatmic or the hidden meaning behind it. Now, during that education, from among the 100 sub-students at one hermitage, 10 students wanted to go back to their village to visit their parents and to celebrate the festival. And unlike this nowadays students, those students are well-versed with all the education because they are trained and bonded and, you know, given, you know, all sort of education by the parents. And then when they are at the hermitage, they know how to walk a long distance, how to climb the tall trees, and how to cross the rivers. They have all kind of skills. So they wanted to visit. And during that day, unfortunately, the Rishi was not able to take them back. So he was a little bit concerned. But one among the 10 students, he volunteered, Guruji, I will take them. I'll take the responsibility. We'll go and visit and we'll come safely. So hesitatingly, he has given the permission. And this story is not like Paramananda Shishulakata. And that was a story which was, you know, with a hidden meaning of wise and wisdom with a comedy. But this story is hidden meaning with a tragedy. And tragedy of the life, tragedy of, you know, our samsara. But let's see what happened. So these 10 students, they started going back to their village and they had to cross a river, which was swiftly running. But they said, you know, let's cross it with the combined power. So they hold the hands together. They started crossing the river. When they were crossing on that one, almost at the end of the river, there was a, you know, little bit of more water and swiftly running. So they got separated. By somehow they all swam to the other bank, and this leader had to be responsible, make sure that everybody is counted. So they were scared, and because of the, you know, the difficulty, they had to get onto the shore. And the leader made them, okay, line up, let us count. So he lined up all the students, and then he was counting 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. 10th is missing. Oh my God, let me count backwards. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Still 9? He got worried. And maybe I'm counting wrong. He stood in the line and he made one of the students count. Again, he did the same thing, 1 to 9. They got scared. And particularly the leader was banging his head. Oh my God, what should I tell my guru? What should I tell my parents, their parents? I took the responsibility. So he was a little bit stressed. And then all the students also, they went around. Maybe one of the students swam ahead and went to the forest. So they went down the stream, went up into the forest. They've searched everywhere. And with much fear and, you know, worry and, you know, crying, all those things. This was seen by the nearby, a wise person sitting down, said, you know, he watched this tamasha, this drama. Then he came to them and he asked the leader, what's the matter, my boy? He says that, sir, you know, he gave the narrative that what is the purpose and how they missed the 10th person. I know the 10th person. I can show you where is the 10th person. So he made all this, you know, to cut it short, they made all the students line up, counting 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and then pointing the finger at the leader. You are the 10th person. Ha! They got relieved on that one. Now, this story will be, you know, taken as a some people criticized, both Westerners and even our Hindus criticized, what is a simple story, and being that wise and getting trained, they don't know how many they counted beginning, they don't know who is the 10th person. We don't take in literal sense. The 10th person has a deeper meaning on that one. So let us look into this, the essential meaning behind this 10th man story on that one. Shesha Chilegaru, can I have the share the slides now, please? Now let's look into the essential meaning behind that one. What is the 10th? Now we all know, we have a concept. In our daily life, we'll be looking into, see that most of the time, what happens, you know, we'll be counting the number 1 to 10, and we'll be counting all the things in our life, and we'll be, you know, from the birth to the death, you know, there are so many numbers we count on that one. Even sometimes we'll be worried, simple things like that, we'll put the glasses up on the head, and then see, we'll forget, and we'll be looking everywhere. And a mother sometimes holding the child in her shoulders, she'll be going around, where is my child? Or we'll be going and then counting, you know, outside, and then going into the Mars, going into the stars, going into the distant places. All these things we are trying to search for something. Why? The 10th is the happiness. Everybody is looking for that 10th. It is the Purnam. The one becoming the 10. We one becoming 1 to 9 and it becomes 10. So there is a creation that one alone is the beginning. You call it God, total intelligence, or Shakti, whatever you call it, unknown. That force, whoever will call in God, you call Brahman, you call, you know, Allah, you call any other religions, you know. That is the unified source or field of energy is called God. That is called absolute consciousness, that awareness that there is something behind our activities. So we will be actually looking for that one to have empower that energy within us. And that nature is the Satchitananda. That absolute consciousness is behind our perception. We cannot see it, we cannot touch it, we cannot feel it by given indriyas, but we can do it by intuitive power, knowing that one, because you always try to travel outside, looking for the happiness somewhere. We'll be looking for happiness in the people, things, and all those things. And we will keep our wife, our spouses, our children, and we have expectations with that. We are looking for that happiness. But unfortunately, in day-to-day life, what happens, that when we are looking for that happiness with the expectations, even if you have that happiness is there, but it's only transient. It is not permanent. Moreover, the same thing that is giving the happiness in the beginning can give the dukkha. And that's why most of the time that our shastras, beginning from the Vedic to Puranas, in between so many literatures, you know, including the Ramayana, Mahabharata, all this literature is meant for that. Happiness within you and happiness, you are that happiness, and you have to travel inwards rather than going outwards and see how that our shastras explain in by stepwise. Next, please. Now, that one energy, total energy, the creation, is the one which is nirakara, niruguna, nirvishesha. There is no shape, no name, and no attributes. That becomes two. Why? All our shastra says that, you know, one, we are alone. When I was a boy, I was alone, myself. I can play it anytime what I want. But, you know, later on, I got married and the children and other things. So, see how I expanded? Because I got bored. So the universal energy, that Brahman, is that one wants to become two because he got bored, let me become many. So he became as Sakara Saguna. Savishesha Brahma means with the Nama Rupa, with all attributes. So that is what the reason is, a reflective consciousness. The original consciousness has become reflection. So you look into that. So also in our daily life, we look for happiness, even though it is within us, we are the happiness. We look the happiness in our children, in our wife, you know, we look for in our friends and out there on the things. We want to look for the happiness outside through them. That's a drama. That's the Bhagavan Leela, we call it. So one becoming two. Next, please. Now, how do we do this drama? So that one big, for the drama you need to have, there are three things that we need to remember in our life. Entire life, we are only three things that we come across. Our interaction, our life is interaction of these three. Number one is Jiva, that's you and me, Jiva. Number two is Jagat, that stage where we are there, our home, you know, our country, you know, our globe. This is a stage, Jagat, all including the planets and everything. And the third one is Jagadishwara, the one who is responsible to running the Jiva and also the Jagat. So it's a Jiva, Jagat and Jagadishwara. These are the three. So in order to have this play, the Bhagavan Leela, because that's what we do every day. It's a play within the family, play outside, footballs and all those things. Because you want to do it because you want to be happy, including the child to the till the end of our life. We are always looking for that happy. For the drama, this one become now three, which is the generator Brahma, operator is the Vishnu, and dissoluter or the, you know, dissolver is the Shankara. So G-O-D, generator, operator, and destroyer. Now these three, with those three energies, one creates, one operates, one dissolutes. And our entire life is, we wake up, we act during the daytime, and then we go to sleep. This is all, a one day is equivalent to that. Okay, next please. Now, this knowledge has been given through the four Vedas, and Rig Veda, Yajur Veda, Sama Veda, Adharva Veda. These are the four Vedas. But actually one Veda, we have only one Veda. The knowledge that we have is only fraction of that is left behind. Because of this invasion and destruction, all those things, the original knowledge has been scattered around and it's inbuilt, because most of it is parampara, karna parampara. It is a Shruti knowledge. It has never been changed. They could not, you know, change that one. That has been still going on in our Bharat Kanda. Okay, next please. Now, this creation needs something to be formed. You need a Jagat. You need a combination of the material. So these five elements, which we know from the subtlest, which you cannot see or touch it, because it's infinite, that's space. From the space comes the air, from the air comes the fire, from the fire comes the, you know, the water, from the water comes the earth. From the subtlest to the grossest, that's why earth you can see it, space you cannot see it. So these five elements are the reason for making entire creation, including me and you. Everything is made up of these five elements with the different combinations, and those combinations because of the three gunas. Because in the combination, when you combined with this, all these things, you will have three gunas, which is a sattvika, rajasika, and tamasika. These three combinations is true for everything in the nature, either it's a non-living or living. So we are made up of these five elements. Next, please. Now, these five elements are responsible for five senses, jnanendriyas. These five elements are responsible for five in karmendriyas. All these 10 indriyas are out of those things. Without that, we don't have any the sensations. We don't have any objectivity. But here, to run these five elements and five senses or five organs of function or reaction, we need a mind. That's why our mind is the instrument. It is a reflective thing that acts that one. We need the mind. But at the same mind could be used as a friend. It also could be your own enemy. Let's see how that happens. The manas is the sixth sense. Next, please. buddhi. The seventh one is the buddhi, intellect. Intellect is the processing mind. Whatever we are getting into our mind regarding day-to-day life, we need to see, you know, what is this, you know, is it the right thing or wrong thing? Is it a dharma or a dharma? And that is the reason that we need all this kind of discriminating power. That's called intellect. Next one, please. How do you do the intellect? Well, you know, discrimination. You have to have some kind of memory. Chitta. Those are the karmic imprints, whether it's a now or previous janma, recent past or the remote past. So all this memory chip in our brain, in our entire body, from the entire body to the smallest cell, this memory chip will be there. In that one, our karmic imprints are there. So this buddhi, what it will be doing is picking up the, you know, the previous one, that memory, which is good, which is bad, based upon the experience. If the child touches the fire, you know it burns. So naturally that is, she won't be touching on that one. If you have a wrong investment, if you are doing something else, you know it is wrong. Or you have behaved bad, it is, you're wrong. So with the kind of shastras telling be good, do good type of thing, punya papa, all those things, memory bank will be there in the storage, which we call it as the Sanchita bank. Then later on, according to that, it will be fructifying, and this buddhi will be taken out of this memory and give it to the mind. And this is what is the proper to do it. You do it, and mind acts on that one. Next, please. Now, everything is going good. You know, we planned everything. We wake up, we see the children. Our children are getting ready to the school, and I'm going to the job, and the wife is going to be occupied with something. Everything is planned. But according to that buddhi, according to the imprint, memory, experience, and according to the mind action, these are all three okay. But now ego comes. It's me. It's mine. Because we are attached to that body and mind, which is covered with the five koshas, pancha koshas we call it. And we forget we came from one, which is self, and we are many. Self in me, in self in all. We forget that, no, it is me. I am the reason. I am the reason you are here. I am the reason that you are able to do this one. I did this. It is mine. It's everything is, that is the ego edging God out. EGO is the main reason why we get into the problems. Next, please. Now, remember, we took from the one to the 10, and systematically we tried one becoming the many, one becoming nine, and ultimately the one which is avyakta, and then becoming the vekta with all the in-between numbers, and then becomes the 10 withdrawal. Look at that shakti, that energy holding all this trinity. Everything is inside, all this. And Lord Krishna, when he mentioned when he gave the discourse to the Arjuna, in the 11th chapter, Vishwarupa, everything is seen, everything is included, everything is one, but you look, you know, with a different nama rupa. That's why ekam sat vipraha bahudha vadanti. That one is one, that God, whatever you call, whatever the name you call, that God is one, but we call with the name. Why is called with the different names? That is the truth. With this 10th, which is the story of the 10th man shows that no matter what is in between the numbers, no matter what is the in-between attributes, it is all one for Bhagavan Leela. And here we have to play the game with praying him, because we are the root cause. Our attitude should be that this is the one that we came. Everything is given. Everything script is given. But unfortunately, we forget the script. And then we get the ahankara, because we are attached to the body, mind, senses. And then we forget the inside, which is hiding inside one and pervading throughout the every cell. We forget that. That's why we are subjected to dukkha and sukha type of thing, all opposites on that. Now, from here, we'll see what is the kind of these essence is told through the different stages. Our shastras, when Vedavyasa gave the Vedic knowledge, it was known to only a learned persons, elite group who have been those called Brahmanas, not by the caste I'm talking about. Brahmanas are the people who have learned this one, the people who have been very well versed with this knowledge of the God, they are called Brahmana. And the Kshatriyas are the one who protects all this drama, all these borders, all those things. And the businessmen are the farmers who are the supporters. And then Shudras are the servicemen, just like in the Purusha Sukta. And it has been beautifully said that one becoming many is the head, is the Brahmana, hands are the Kshatriya, body is the Vaishya, and then your legs and feet are the Shudras, servicemen. Nobody is superior than the other. Nobody is inferior than the other. You need the body to act, all of them together, Samhita. And then you need to sing together, which is the Brahmana. And you need to have act together. All these things, we need to understand that there is a cohesion, it's a play, that we need to play a given role. That's why Varnashrama Dharma, based upon your gunas, those three gunas, how they combine together. Now, once we have this knowledge, there is a seven-step kind of knowledge to have this moksha, towards the moksha. For that one, our shastras, our rishis have given a beautiful path. Is they given a bridge, they constructed a bridge to cross the river, like the 10th man, the story, that in order to cross this river, which is the river is nothing but samsara, riddled with so many things, because we told you that there is no happiness in this world, in samsara. We are born because we are so fortunate to be born as a human being in order to exhaust all those things and then go back to him or go back to the self, which you are yourself, which is called Sat Chit Ananda. Sat is the existence, Chittam is the knowledge, consciousness, and Anandam is your Swarupa. Just like the fire has its heat and the light, it is the inherent nature. And our inherent nature is the loving and giving. That's why the heart rate is always the sounds with the love and give. And the lub-dub is the 72 beats. And I'll tell you proudly that 72 has a significant number. Then we'll go back to the 10 number to end with that in conclusion. But let me tell about the seven stages of realization, how we do that. They have put this purushardhas. Ardha, first dharma. The dharma is the first one, first pillar. Then you have ardha, kama, moksha. Dharma is the one which is pervading throughout all these three. Without the dharma, there is no beauty, there is no happiness in that one. Then you have in between, you need to have that ardha according to conformity to the dharma. Kama is also according to the dharma. Then ultimately these three together gives you art of living, how best you can live your life. Then it will take you to the moksha, which is the goal of life on that one. For that one, these rishis tell, there are seven stages of spiritual climbing, the seven steps you can climb. Number one is you take away your ignorance. Ignorance is that you are not the body, mind, senses. You are the Atma inside, which is only this body is only equipment. You play your role, praying him, remembering him, that one. So that particular aspect is called ignorance. And that ignorance is the one which is sometimes called as maya, illusion, all those things. But why this ignorance? Is because of the avarna. Avarna means it's a... am I passing the time, sir? Chalai Garu? How much time?
No, sir. Continue. No.
Right. The avarna. Avarna is the second one. Avarna is the covered. Because we are ignorant, because we don't know anything. Just like the baby when it's in the womb 9 months, it's everything's dark. And and then even up to the 3 years old, everything is, it has to be taught to her because it's all covered knowledge on that. So also when we are growing up, if you don't know something, you don't know the other person, you don't know your wife, I've married for 40 years, 50 years, and it is still a covered knowledge. You don't know that. You need to discover that one. And this discover word is from that is avarana. The next one is vikshepa. The vikshepa is the one which is projection, that you mistaken intellect, you will misunderstand the people, and then you misunderstand your own, you know, the family members, including your wife and children and friends and relatives and all of them. You don't understand them. All this racial discrimination because of the false knowledge and false, you know, misapprehension of that knowledge. It is called vikshepa. And simple example in the Vedic period they gave is, what they did is they compared a rope with snake. When you see in a semi-darkness on the way, if you see a rope, it looks like it's, you know, the snake. Then if you see a stump of the tree, it looks like a ghost. A post looks like a ghost. So this is a misapprehension. You project something else. So you project these things on your family members, on your friends, on your different countries. So that's why all this misunderstanding comes with the vikshepa. What do we have to do for that? Research. Whatever you lost that knowledge, you do the research on that one. Then after that one, then how do you do this research? And the fourth one is called paroksha jnana. See, most of us with the five senses is a limited knowledge. You can see only a certain distance. You cannot see the more than that. You know only your own world. You don't know the other countries. You don't know the planets. You don't know the... So our senses are limited. So in that limited senses, that paroksha, sometimes indirect knowledge. What is that one? If there is a smoke on the mountain, you will see, you know that there is a fire underneath that one. So this is the knowledge was given. But much more knowledge was given by the Veda Pramana, Shabda Pramana, Nadam Brahmam, Shabdam Brahmam. These two things, because this is authoritative, it is not given by the human being. It was already by intuitive knowledge, by given by the rishis. They have tuned into, just like a TV set tunes that, you know, all these, their pictures and everything. The rishis tuned those knowledge. It's given by the God. It is not, you know, man-made. It is apaurusheya. And that is the one we need to have that is available. The other one, the rishis, the fifth one is the aparoksha anubhuti, directly immediate intuitions. Sometimes we get the intuitions based upon our knowledge, based upon our practice, sadhana. That intuition can take you direct knowledge. And that's when you feel, I am Brahma. That's why four Mahavakyas through the Vedas told us, Prajnanam Brahma. Prajnanam Brahma is that Brahman is the knowledge. Brahman is the consciousness. That alone, only there is only God. That's not one God, two Gods. Or, you know, everything is God. That Prajnanam Brahma. After that, when we go to the Gurukula, or the parents will tell, Tattvam Asi, you are that one. Don't forget that. So we'll be teaching that. Then after that, when we are Gruhastha life, we'll be practicing. Okay, I am Atma Brahma. This is that Atma. Then after the experience with the intuition, with the knowledge, further knowledge, listening to the gurus or reading the scriptures, you will say, declare that one at the end. Aham Brahma Asmi. I am that Brahman. That I is the Brahman. I am is not that I am Brahman, I am the God. I is the only one, that self in me, in self in all. If the self in me, in self in all, and whatever causes you happiness, it should be giving the happiness to everybody, right? So also whatever you are hurting, that should be hurting. So don't hurt. And whatever makes the happiness, give that happiness. Be good, do good. That is the Shastras have been told that one. And that is the one, is the reason that our Shastras build up these four Purushardhas and then explain it. So, and the seventh one, the sixth one is the dukkha pravruti. Dukkha nivruti. Dukkha nivruti means take away dukkham. How do you take out? Take out the ignorance. And then sukha prapti, the seventh one. Seventh stage is sukha prapti. That is sukha prapti is what? That's what you are. Realize that happiness is not somewhere else. The tenth one is you, the first one. And in between is the drama. The tenth becomes the one. One becomes the ten. That's the Bhagavan Leela. And that is called the Kaivalyam. That's called moksha. And this is what the knowledge has been hidden with this 10th man story. And to conclusive on this knowledge is that this 10 is very important number in our life. 10 is the paripurnata, purnam. One is the one ultimate Brahman, all alone. And the 10 is the purnam. Zero was invented on the Bharatakanda. One is invented by the Bharatakanda. And combined is also invented by the Bharatakanda, by rishis and seers. This is the great knowledge has been given through the scriptures. Now, if you look into that, one of the things it will be surprising to see, the creation of all these human beings, all these creatures, there are 84 lakhs different species. All of them are created according to the Nasadiya Suktam. When they have created this one, they have created in 10 sargas, 10 different phases. And also when it is explained by Karna Parampara from Vedic Rig Veda, there are 10 mandalas in that one. And when over the time period, we have 4 yugas. The yuga, first yuga is the Satya Yuga. Then the second is the Treta Yuga. Third one is Dwapara Yuga. And the fourth one is the Kali Yuga. Kali Yuga, one time, make two times of that, it makes the Dwapara, Dwa. Three, Treta Yuga, three. And then four is the Satya Yuga. Now remember, if you add this 6 plus 4, 4 times is called one Chatur Yuga Mahayuga, and it takes 1,000 yugas for one Brahma day. So that is also 10. Now look at this, the beauty. The 10, Dasha Avataras. Dasha Avataras also according to this time period. When the mind was pure and our Dharma was standing on the 4 legs, which we call it in English terms, on that one is austerity and purity, charity and clarity. These 4 legs, when they were there, practiced perfect in Satya Yuga, gods were moving very freely among the human beings. That's why there are more avatars in the Satya Yuga. And when it is come to the Treta Yuga, only 3 avatars. When it comes to the Dwapara, there are only 2 avatars. And now we are waiting for 1 avatar. The gods are distancing ourselves from the human beings now. So in Satya Yuga, when this 10 is the number very important, not only the scientific theory, evolution theory is wrong, in a way, if you compare to our spiritual science, it's an evolution of the consciousness. That in Satya Yuga to Kali Yuga, there's a deterioration of these values are there. So if you look into the avatars carefully in Satya Yuga, we have a Matsya avataram, we have Kurma avataram, Varaha avataram, then Nrsimha avataram. Then these are the 4, from water life to animal life, from non-vertebrate to the vertebrate, to the combination of the man and the animal. And then those 4 are in Satya Yuga. Then 3 are in the Treta Yuga. What are the Treta Yuga 3? Vamana, Parashurama, and Rama. Then you come to the Dwapara Yuga. Then come down to only 2 avatars. And this further developments, looking into that, Vamana is the short, but is almighty power, but is not able to express that one. That's why the evolution of the human consciousness on the drama level is not perfect. Then becomes all of a sudden Parashurama with all violence against the Kshatriyas, and because he only knows how to kill the bad, but he doesn't know how to do that. But Rama is a next avatar, is the personification, more refined. Dharma is the most important. Violence is necessary, but with the dharmic level. So don't go appositely kill just like a Parashurama. So it's an evolution, further evolution. Then the politics came into that one. Then coming into the Dwapara Yuga, Sri Krishna is much more political, and he has managed that one. But as the age going down, Balarama. Balarama is the one, but sometimes they say Buddha avataram is the ninth avataram, enlightened one. Whether it's a Balarama or the Buddha avataram is the ninth considered, and we are waiting for the tenth. So these 10 numbers is also very important. And lastly, I would like to tell, this 10 number is also important when we are doing our Karmakanda or Jnanakanda, and when we do the Vishnu Sahasranamam, and sometimes we don't have the time in those in present days. Vishnu Sahasranama, 1,000 names. How do we? 1,000 is infinitive. Then when Parvati asks, in the Kali Yuga, it's very difficult for the human beings to, you know, go through all these thousands. Is there anything there? What does the Shiva answers? Sri Rama Rama Rameti Rame Rame Manorame Sahasranama Tatulyam Ramanama Varanane. And three times you do that, three times if you do it is equivalent to the 1,000 names of Vishnu Sahasranama. Why three times? Because Ra and Ma, our Sanskrit language is the richest language, is the mother of all languages, and Sanskrit is the expression of that Veda. Sanskrit is nothing but objectivity. All objects are seen by the sound. Our science proves. The science proves that all its vibrations that makes you, table, planets, everything is. It's a vibration, wave vibration theory. So, nadam brahmam, shabdam brahmam. All creativity, objectivity is because of this nadam brahmam, shabdam brahmam. So, with that one, what happens is that once we realize this, everything is made of, you know, shabdam and nadam. So we need to realize also one other point I wanted to conclude is that in the 54 letters that we have noticed, there are 15 vowels, achu, and then other one is vajjanjari, the vowels is 33. 33 is the 33 type of guts, 15 is the panchendriyas and panchapranas and tanmantras. These are all five. All 15 are all. Without those vowels, the consonants cannot work. Without the human beings, there are no gods. Without the gods, there are no drama. And there is the energetic, which is the Krishna, and there is the energy, which is the Radha. Without the energy, there is no expression of the energetic. And without energetic, there is no Radha. There is no energy. So these are all ekameva advitiyam. It's all together. So these 10 numbers, when you look into that, these 54 letters, and this ma has the number 5 in that row of those things, and whereas the ra has a 2 number. 2 times 5, 3 times you are turned. These are Sri Rama Rama Rameti, and 10 times 10 times 10 is 1,000. And that's how our number 10 has a significant importance on that one. At this time, and I thank you very much, the organizers, particularly Prabhakar Garu, Seshachalaya Garu, for giving an opportunity to share my knowledge, and I'm open for the discussion. And it's an interactive. I am only just a speaker today, and you are listeners, and you are the speaker tomorrow. I am the listener. And education is a mutual one, and learning is mutual, because we know the self is not a two. Self is only one. Self in me, self in all. And this is how. And Ananda is nothing but within you. And it's you. Ananda is called Sat Chit Ananda. Let's make this drama enjoyable. Let's make sure that the day in and day out is giving happiness yourself, giving, spreading that happiness everywhere is the goal of the life that's called moksha. And moksha is not nothing but somewhere in heaven. And there is no heaven and anywhere. It is in your mind. Heaven is there, concept. But, you know, in order to be going to the heaven, you have to travel. You have so many things you have to do. But in order to have that happiness, it is within you, within your own heart. And that self-realization is, it's very easy and free and is available. And keeping a smile on that one and giving the smile, and it's all, it will be, you know, paripurnata. That's called moksha on that one. Om Purnamada Purnamidam पूर्णात् पूर्णमुदच्यते पूर्णस्य पूर्णमादाय पूर्णमेवावशिष्यते। ओम शांति शांति शांति। ही दिस आत्मा दिस इंडिविजुअल दिस जीवा इज फुल दैट जीवा इज फुल एंड इफ दिस जीवा इज टेकन आउट ऑफ दैट फुल रिमेन्स फुल एंड जस्ट लाइक ए ओशन नो मैटर हाउ मेनी साइक्लोन्स हाउ मेनी थिंग्स कम आउट ऑफ दैट वन ओशन गो डू नॉट गो डाउन इन द लेवल नो मैटर हाउ मेनी फ्लड्स हाउ मेनी रिवर्स ज्वाइन देयर ocean remains the same. That full, that Bhagavan, that energy is nothing but all one and we are part. We are Amsha. Once we know we are Amsha of that one whole and we'll be happy because that is the connection because you are happiness. That's the Satchitananda. Namaste. Questions in open for them.
Hello, Dr. Chandraji. Can you explain the Hridayam?
Okay. Did you say Hridayam?
Hridayam, on heart, you know. You say that okay. It's not the actual heart we call, but it's something else. Can you explain that?
Yeah. Hridayam means it is not the physical heart. Hridayam is the, just like, let's say, the Maha Akasha, the infinity that you see it, when it is concentrated, the smallest one to the atom, center of your body, center of that energy, even though that energy is in the, all the cells, at one place that is there in the center, that's called Hridayam. That Hridayam is the one which is a spontaneous beating, spontaneous sound, spontaneous supply of the circulation, along with that vibration that takes place when the heart, the flow of the blood is going through the arteries and it is supplied, that vibration picked up by 101 main nadis, then it becomes the 72,000 nadis. That's also 72. Then physical heart, according to the science, is also 72 beats, and that beats also gives you that one. So the 72, and this is very precise thing, Ramji, is the 72 number as a significance, because entire Bhagavad Gita song, the song of the God, in it is explained in the second chapter, Sankhya Yoga, 72 slokas, and it is also then summarized everything in the 18th chapter in 72 slokas, even though it has the 78 slokas, last six slokas are the palaslokas, 72 slokas, and 72 slokas of, you know, in the second chapter are equivalent to the 72 beats of your heart, the physical heart, and also 72,000 nadis that vibrates to the every cell to have your action to run your life on the Purusharthas. Did I answer you that one, Ramji?
Yes, yes. Thank you, Dr. Chandraji. Thank you so much.
After, will you little elaborate purity, charity, and clarity?
As I told you, as I mentioned, Dharma is the expression of that energy on a very strict natural law, order. Dharma is defined as a duty and also natural law and also righteousness, doing good, being good. That is the nature of Dharma. That Dharma stands on the four legs. As I said, austerity is the tapas. Tapas is the number one. The concentration, sadhana, that you are the Amsha of that one, and then you are only the part to act here for the pleasure of that your own, that Atma. And that is called tapas, intense concentration with the sadhana, with a good attitude, with devotion, which is called upasana or meditation, and the third one is called sharanagati to the Ishvara. That is called tapas, number one. Second leg is swachha. Is the purity. Swachha is not only just the external body cleanliness, it is manasa, vacha, karmana. Your thinking and your speech and your actions should be swachha. And that is the purity. And the third one is charity. Remember that everything is given, including your body, all the assets, everything on this earth, everything is given. We are born is only to guard and to exhaust our own previous karma imprints. We are only guardians. We think that we fathered our own child. No, child went through us because our own Atma having an act, an extension. That's why in Pitrupaksha, in Shraddha, what we do? We do Pinda to the three generations. Because your own Atma, depending upon your karmic imprints, will be ascending one level to the other level. And because of that one, you will be doing this Pinda. And this is the, because everything is given, give. Charity is the third leg.
Dana.
And the fourth one is a clarity. That clarity is, you have to remember which is Atma, which is Anatma, which is real, which is unreal. And once you know which is real, unreal, then you will know this is all Nimitta Matra. We are here only to play the Bhagavan Leela and be good, do good. That clarity has to be there. If you don't have the clarity, then you misunderstand. I told you, Avarana and Vikshepa, and these are all kind of things will come into that, and then the life will be miserable. Then we'll fight raga, dukkha, you know, raga, dvesha, dukkha, sukha, all those the opposite will come onto that one. And so that is the clarity. And these four legs in Kali Yuga, when Parikshit, you know, Maharaja was going on the shore, he has seen that bull was, you know, lying down there with the legs broken. Only one leg is only the satya, the clarity is only there. Three legs are gone in the Kali Yuga. And that's what it is for. Did I answer you, ma'am? Okay.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
So, Garu? Thank you very much. So clear, and explanation is simply, doesn't arise any kind of questions because the explanation is so clear. And we all understand clearly, and moreover, the slideshow that you have made may make us to ascend up to moksha. Beautiful analysis, and so we have any other, I think after all, the stories form the basis for understanding, for knowledge, and for realization, because stories are attractive. And right from Vedic times and even today, children love it, but elders will get a lot of message, instruction, and initiation. So that way, I am very thankful that you have just, all people talk about the 10 Shishyas and their stupid actions and their foolish behavior and all that, but people laugh at it. And but to see the 10th one, because 10 decades is a usual grant of time that we have been given. So decade by decade, there are going to be a lot of changes in anybody's life, human life. But the last decades are important. The first few decades, 5 decades up to, all are very busy and not able to spend time otherwise. But it is said that after 55th decade or 6th decade, actual journey begins. And then we try to go to the Shanti, Shanti and Shanti. Something like Rama, Rama, Rama. So when we, that Shanti has its own layers. And so he said, that Sukha, what Sukha, just now we mentioned, as in Bhagavad Gita, Krishna said, Adyavanta ime Sukhaha Dukkha Yonaya Evate. Beautiful statement. All those sukhas which have got the origin, beginning, ultimately they will only lead to dukkha. So we have to search such sukha which has no origin, that is Paramatma. So I think beautiful analysis, sir. Thank you very much. You have made it well understood, and there is no surprise in that. It's quite clear and understandable, and thank you very much. We expect you to participate in this series of lectures, and in fact you should also plan to give one beautiful talk on Bhagavad Gita, because you explained second chapter and this 18th chapter to be having 72 important, and if at all more slokas are there, that's a Phalasruti and all that. That is why even Rigveda, the first mandala and 10th mandala are the big mandalas. The second mandala and the 9th, they're all family mandalas. So there is a difference. That's why the people say that, academicians say that second to other mandala up to 9th mandalas are earlier day, while fixing the date. But anyway, you really see substantial focus in the Rigveda 7th mandala. Even in Ramayana also, look at the Ayodhya Kanda and Yuddha Kanda. So like that, you have that kind of sandwiching the material between two important layers. And so very beautiful, sir. Thank you very much. We all enjoyed. And I hope Rasheshachalaya has done a wonderful job, and he will put it in the YouTube and make it more and more reachable to many people, because in India it's a light hour, but for in America it's a day hour. So there will be people coming and going and all that. But still, I'm very thankful to all of those who have joined and remained till the end and enjoyed the last sip of the whole show. So thank you very much, Dr. So though he has been in a medical profession, but try to see some poetry in the medicine, poetry in the anatomy. And we have seen that. And congratulations, and thank you very much. May God give you all good health and prosperity, and able to share the Vedantic knowledge also to the people, so that they really get benefited with this. Because without Vedanta, life becomes really morose. Will not enjoy. So if the a tinge of Vedanta knowledge, that's why Adhyatma Nityatvam Tattva Jnana Artha Darshanam. These are the two aims in our life, which Dr. Chandra Reddy is able to live it and then show it to people. And so thank you very much, sir.